Welcome everyone to this session about information management as a service, how to use the services of OpenText, and how the admin service works, and how to log in. So let's start with the developer.opentext website. As you can see, we have APIs we provide to you, and there are a lot of interesting ones. But how can you use these? So let's first look at this API, Mention Secure. This API, you first need to register. And so let's do that. I already, to register, you go to sign up and you follow the form because it will take too long. I already am registered. So I will go to the other window. Let's see. Not this one, but this one. So as you see, I'm here already signed in and we can go to the plans page. We're going to select the free trial plan page, and it gives me one tenant and max of 5 apps. So let's sign up. I need to provide a name. So sample app, country, some purpose, demonstration, and make sure I check the check marks, and it will now create for me an organization environment in the OpenText. It will take a bit of time. This is important. Make sure you copy this password and download your configuration file. Next, we can go to the console. I already opened it in another window. So here you see the console. As you can see, there's already one tenant created. We have no apps at the moment. And if you select this part, this is the organization. You can create an app. If you create an app here, it's not assigned to a tenant. If you create it here, it will be directly assigned to the tenant. More interesting things to see is you have here your organization ID, which we need later on in the management API. And you can change your password. You can use or change your service clients. These are needed for authentication, which will also be shown later. And for the tenant, you can also reset this password. And you can also go to manage, then it will open up more details and you can edit the tenant details. So now we have a tenant, but we want to use the services. So if we go back to this page, let's close this and let's go to the APIs. And then manage and secure. And we have the development administration API. As you can see, we can do things with apps, with tenant users, with authenticators, and with the organization itself. To show the use of this, we have created a sample application. You can download that from GitHub. You can find the location in the comment section of this video. And if you've downloaded it and unzipped it or extracted it with Git, sorry, pulled it with Git, then you will have the following structure. So there's a README, and the README will explain the same thing I'm going to discuss further in this session. And there's a properties. That's an easy way to provide your configuration details so you don't have to fill it in every time again. Now first, let's start by downloading the dependency. As you can see, I'm using npm, so make sure you have npm installed. In the README file, you can find the location where you can download it from. And if you have installed it, then we can start it. So npm start. During startup, it will ask some questions. For example, which hostname do you want to use? Well, localhost is fine most of the time. And I want to be secure, so I want to use HTTPS. Now the sample application has started on this port. So let's open up the application. As you can see here, I will reload it. You see here, it's not secure, and the reason is it's a self-signed certificate. If you want to be secure, you have to install your own certificate, which is not self-signed. Anyway, let's continue. So there are three sections. So we have things you want to do on organization level, there are things you want to do on tenant level, and on user level and tenant user, a user of the tenant. Let's open the organization page. As you can see, I filled the properties file. So these settings are automatically filled by the properties files. Important to know is that we can choose between two authentication flows. The first one is the password grant flow. It's the OpenID. So read the OpenID specification or more things on the internet if you want to know more of it. And the other one is the authorization code with PKC. For this one, we need a secret. So this is called the confidential client. And for this one, we use a public client. So let's first log in with the password grant flow. Everything is filled in, as you can see, and I can press login. Now the login is done and I have a token, so I can do service calls. But first I will show a little bit more about what's happening under the hood. For that we go to the code and we open the login.hmm. So we see here there's a form with the fields you could see in the sample application, and we jump into the login method, which is called when you do the login, click on the login button. It will store the inputs so it can be reused. So if you change something next time, it will also show the new values. And then it checks which flow do we want to use. Well, if it's password flow, we're going to follow the password flow code. First, it will fetch the OpenID configuration. And so that once more. So I will open up the debugger F12. And I'm going to look at the network traffic. I want to make sure that I preserve the log. And I'm going to log once more. As you can see on the network, let's continue this one. On the network, I have an OpenID configuration call. If we look at the response, or maybe preview is easier to, then you can see it is contains the OpenID configuration. And we're going to use the token endpoint to do for the password flow. So now we can go back to the code. We see here get OpenID configuration that's doing this call. And it fetches the information from the form. Then it will execute a post call to the token endpoint, which is fetched from the OpenID configuration. And it will provide the client secret. It say, I want to use the password flow and the username and password. The call is returned. It will be handled by the token endpoint response. And it fetches the access token and the ID token from the response and stores it in the session storage. So that's how this flow works. Now we can create an application, an app. I provide a name, display name, a description, telling where I want to use the application for, and a version and where the application is hosted. As you can see, I use the same one as my endpoint. So let's submit this and it will create the application for me. Now we can go to the console again. Let's go to the console. And we will go to the organization, and you see the application is created. I can look into the details of the application by clicking on it, and then I can see here the service clients which I use for the application. Again, you can see there's a confidential and the public part. The confidential one has a secret, you can regenerate it, and you can add redirect URLs, you can revoke it, and for the public, the same. And take care, here is the client ID, which can be used for authentication. Okay, now we go back to our sample application. Here we have the response of creating the application, and there we also see the service clients. You see here the non-confidential one, that's the public one, and the public one. And here again, we see the consumer key, which is also the client ID, and the redirect URLs. So to use the authorization code with PKCE, that's a front-end flow. So if I use this flow, it will redirect me to the IDP, and the IDP will redirect back to me. But because I don't want to have a wildcard on redirects, I would want to say which redirect URLs are may be used. This one is the OpenText IDP, and this one is that I want to use redirect to my own host. So let's now add these redirect URLs to my application. For that, I need my application ID. And I need the client ID for which I want to change redirect URL. Because I want to use the public client, I use this ID, where the confidential is false. And I into this box. So let's submit, and now the redirect URLs are adjusted. Next thing I can do is create a tenant, but because this is a trial account, I can have only one tenant, so this will fail if I try to create one more. I can show. No, I have to provide an email, of course. And then it says you may not create one, but we already have one, so let's continue. Next thing I can do is add the application to the tenant. So for that, I again need the application ID. Sure, fill it in the right box, of course. And then I need my tenant ID. So I go back to the console. I select my tenant and I copy the tenant ID and paste it in the box. A tenant is the runtime data, so your data, and the app is the access from OT2 services. So now it's assigned, and we can use this tenant. So we come to the tenant page. You can see we have here exactly the same login, but this is not on our session level, but on tenant level. So let's see if I want to use authorization code with PKCE or the password grant. To use the password grant, I need to provide again my email address. So let's copy that. I need my password of my tenant. So it's very important. Here I fill in my tenant password. If you forget it, then you can go to the console and select tenants, and then press reset password here. And in addition, I'm working on tenant level. So I want to provide here my client ID and client secret of the application I want to use. So I go to my application, and then I want to use the confidential one because I want to use the consumer secrets. I need my consumer key. I provide these, and now I can log in. So now I'm authenticated for my tenant on tenant level. I want to use the Pixie flow for my users which I want to create. So I'm going to create the authenticator for this flow. So first here I've created authenticator, provide the name. I'm going to use SSO Circle. I need an IDP which supports SAML and a provider URL, that's where it can fetch the metadata, and some settings. So let's create that. Now to use this authenticator, I have to configure SSO Circle. So here I already opened SSO Circle, and you can register it as here. I already did that, so I can log in. And next thing I'm going to do is manage my metadata. I can remove the old one, I don't need this, this is the conflict. Wait a little bit. It's metadata. And as you can see here, the SSO Circle public IDP metadata. And this URL was the same one we used when creating the authenticator. So you can also fetch it here. And this contains the SAML configuration for the IDP site. Then I want to add a new service provider because my authenticator is a service provider. I want to use the email address and I need a frequent qualified domain name. For that, I'm going to use this. Take care. I'm using on test systems, so for you this will be a different value. And we need the SAML metadata. In the README, you can find the curl command. I also have it here. And we need to fill in two parts in it, the authenticator ID. So let's go back to the sample application and copy the authenticator ID. And we need the tenant ID. Let's fetch the tenant ID. As you can see, this is also a SAML service provider metadata definition. So we're going to fill it in here. Make sure it ends with the fish brackets and start with the fish bracket and that there's no new line before this. And we can submit it. Take a bit of time. Okay, metadata was successfully imported. So let's go back to the sample application. And we want to create a user which can be used for this authenticator. So we provide the name, Donald at SSO Circle, and email address. This is the email address I used when I registered here at SSO Circle. Then I need to add one more thing. So comma, don't forget the comma, authenticator ID. And we need to provide here the ID of the authenticator we created. Now we have created the user, but to use the user in the application, we must add the user to the application. So here we provide the user ID and we go back to the create app. Here we have the app ID. And we submit. I used probably the wrong app ID. Yeah, indeed, I was using the service client ID. See, here's the application ID. And now the user is signed to the app. So now we can go to the next step. That is the user page. No, because I'm using self-signed certificates. Let's continue. Now I want to say I want to use authorization code with PKCE. I need the client ID. So that's if you go back to the app, Then I want to use the public client. So that's confidential is false. And I need there the consumer ID. So if you are setting the redirect URLs, you need the ID of the client. And if you want to use it for login, you need to use the consumer key. Can be a bit confusing. So let's go back to the user page. Yes, provide the client ID. And now we also need to provide the authenticator ID. We can say that we want to log in. If I now press login, what will happen is we will be redirected to SSO Circle for the login flow. I'm not a robot. And I forgot one thing. This thing went very smooth because I'm still logged in this same session with SSO Circle. So let's log out here. And let's go back here and try to log in once more. Now you see I get a question that I have to provide my credentials. I'm not a robot. And you see I have to log in now as the user dequackle open text. Next thing we can do is upload the file. So as I said at the beginning, we have our APIs. And now we have used the manage and secure part of the APIs. So, but we're now going to use, for example, content storage API. There we go to the content. We want to upload some content for a tenant as a user. And you can see here it's opposed to this endpoint. So I can, you can see here a post to that endpoint. I will submit it. And the content is uploaded. Maybe it's nice that I show a little bit how it works in the sample code itself. So we are now on the user page. You can see here's a tenant page, organization page, and the user page. On the user page, we have a form, upload file. And on submit, it will do this method. You can see it's post and this is the endpoint. So it will create a JSON file. It's very simple. Just a message with some timestamp. You can do anything what you want here in this file. But we did this. And then it will create a request and send it to the endpoint with login token. Here, so we uploaded the file, and next thing we can do is fetch the ID of the uploaded file, and we can download this file. So submit that one, and you can see the document we have created during upload is returned during the download. So in addition to this, you can of course use any other API you want to use from catalog. You can use capturing, digitizing, workflow processing, search and decoupling, and so on. So, but the most important part, you know now how to log in with the password grant or the authorization code with PKC eFlow, both front end. And if you want to see how to work in back end, you can select this, deselect this checkbox. And then it will immediately send it from the backend for backend flow support. Thank you, and I hope you will enjoy using the OpenText services.